Good morning. Pat, if you'd come up. Good morning. I'm Senator Kemp Hannon. We're going to be talking this morning about concussions as they relate to students. It technically is not a concussion, but it's a mild traumatic brain injury. This is work that builds on a number of things that we in the Senate have done over the past about 8 years, starting out when we did not have technology, but began a series of lectures throughout the states of athletic trainers, athletic directors, coaches, on an ongoing basis. They would sponsored conferences. They had return to play cards given to everybody on sidelines. And it's been a developing thing that we created a constituency of people who are involved in student athletics that are aware of the dangers of the near traumatic brain injury. And it is with that as a backdrop that we can now move forward and have, with the heightened consciousness from the high schools and middle schools, along with people being conscious of this from professional athletics, that there needs to be actual legislation that would center on return to play for student athletes, what the guidelines of those return to play guidelines would consist of, an educational component so that people could continue their education, trying to do it in terms of telecommunications so that the consciousness of being mandates these days could be met. So setting up this entire system. Now, we still have more to be done. New York State Athletic Association, consisting of a huge number of volunteers in this state, the coaches, athletic directors, and trainers throughout the state are donating in addition to, they don't get paid very much, and then they donate tons of hours in addition to that, and they have been really the substructure of what has been done already and what will be done. So we want to keep them involved, but when government gets involved, you can't just use people on a volunteer basis. You have to involve the Department of Education. You got to involve the Department of Health. And so that's what we'll be doing through the legislation and moving forward with that. Joining with me today is Senator Greg Ball, who's been vitally interested in this as an issue, and Senator Lee Zeldin. It was actually out of Senator Zeldin's district that I think the original legislation we introduced. We all have schools that are heavily involved in student athletics, and which gives rise to our immediate interest because we obviously see from the daily papers the renewed interest in student athletics throughout the state. I will point out this legislation is not just about athletics. We broaden the coverage to be pupils because in addition, and people would also say, well, the athletics is just football. It goes to soccer, it goes to lacrosse, it goes to basketball, it goes to track, softball, because that's all the places that it can occur in athletics, but it can also occur in physical education, and then it can occur to any student so that someone just involved in horsing around. Which brings us to introducing our guest today is Pat Donahue, founder of the Sarah Jane Brain Foundation, relating out of a in situation in his own family, but he has added a dimension to our concerns in regard to concussions and mild traumatic brain injury because we haven't had the parents involved. We have had it confined to the athletes. So we're trying to broaden it in a couple of different directions. And I'm going to introduce Pat just after. I'm going to ask Senator Zeldin if he wanted to say a few words, and then Senator Ball. Senator Zeldin.
Well, thank you, Senator Hannon, for your leadership on this issue. I've had the opportunity to get to know Patrick and spend some time with his daughter. It's a remarkable sacrifice that Patrick's been making with his own personal time, as well as his efforts around New York State and across the country to bring more awareness to brain injury problems, and they take many forms. I commend Senator Hannon for his leadership on this issue. I look forward to discussions of where we can go from here. As someone who is a reservist and spent a few years on active duty, I enjoy our conversations about what to do with about traumatic brain injury affecting our veterans. And the sky's the limit. There's so much more that our state can be doing. This is an important step, and I'm proud to join both of you today.
Senator Ball.
Sure. Senator Hannon, thank you so much for your leadership on this issue, and I'll be very brief. You know, growing up, I was the geek. I have two brothers who are jocks. And I watched them, they're about 10 years older than me, and I watched them either get off the couch or when they wake up in the morning. And, you know, you can just tell they played lacrosse, they played football, they played hockey. Their bodies are paying the burden. We know things today about traumatic brain injury that we didn't know 20, 30 years ago. And it's not just your bones that are aching. These are serious repercussions, and these children will be dealing with these young athletes can be dealing with these implications years down the road. So this legislation is vitally important, and we have I'm a former Air Force captain. Lee is a Army reservist and a captain, and this legislation goes beyond our students, as Senator Hannon said. We have men and women returning. The good news is that the men and women are returning from Afghanistan and Iraq. The bad news is that they are returning post-traumatic stress disorder, traumatic brain injury, 7% missing one limb or more. And specifically with traumatic brain injury, there are so many hurdles that we still need to overcome in order to do the best that we can for our brave servicemen and women. And it starts here. It starts here with clearing these hurdles with these students today. So it's a pleasure to be here. I'm glad that we're out in front on this legislation, and I look forward to continuing these efforts.
Before I introduce Mr. Donahue, I just point out that the reason we make the connection, as Senator Ball makes a connection with returning vets, is that post-traumatic stress syndrome and the concussions you get from the IEDs along the side of the road are often the same type of overt symptoms. But you need to have a distinguish between what is syndrome, what is a post-traumatic stress syndrome, and what is a concussion in order to do appropriate treatment. So this is pretty important in regard to defense, and I hope in future weeks to have some discussion about what we're doing to help along those lines. Mr. Dunne was mentioning to me some statistics to point out actually how widespread the mild traumatic brain injury is, even among youth sports. We don't discover until later in life, and when people get into difficulties with personal situations or society. And I think that it just modern technology, modern awareness, modern diagnosis widens our awareness of what actually may be going on, and then once we realize the problems, starting to erect systems to address that. Pat, let me give you the mic.
Thank you. Thank you, Senator Hannon, for your leadership, and Senator Ball and Zeldin for being here supporting this piece of legislation. Just as Senator Hannon mentioned, the Sarah Jane Brain Foundation is named after my 5.5-year-old little girl who was violently shaken by a baby nurse when she was just 5 days old, broke 4 ribs, both collarbones, and caused a severe brain injury. Since we launched the Sarah Jane Brain Foundation several years ago, it's grown into one of the largest organizations in the country dealing with the number one leading cause of death and disability for our youth in this country, which is brain injury. To put things into perspective, there are about 50-some-odd thousand new cases of HIV diagnosed every year, and the federal government invests about $3.5 to $4 billion in federal research towards HIV. There's about 24,000 new cases of autism in this country every year. Total cumulative cases of autism in the country is somewhere between 565,000 and 1.2 million, according to the CDC. However, every year, over 765,000 American youth from birth up to 25 enter an emergency department with a new traumatic brain injury. Over 80,000 of them are hospitalized, and over 11,000 die. And that's not even taking into account the 2 to 3 times that amount that aren't diagnosed, and most of those are in the mild traumatic brain injury category. To put things into perspective so that everybody understands, brain injuries are diagnosed into 3 categories: mild, moderate, and severe. To put things into perspective, a mild traumatic brain injury is if you take the brain, which has consistency of, say, about hard jello, and you stick it in front of a car going 20 miles an hour, that's actually considered a mild traumatic brain injury. So I dare people, go stick your cell phone in front of a car going 20 miles an hour and expect that to work and function properly. So far, no one has taken that opportunity. In addition, what most people don't realize is that when you have little Susie or little Johnny, when they're 8 years old and they're playing soccer or they fall out of a tree and they get a concussion, and within a day or so, they seem to be normal, happy-go-lucky, socializing, doing well in school, everybody thinks they dodged a bullet. However, 6 years later, when these students are now in high school and relying upon the executive functioning of their brain for the first time, these kids are going from A students to C students, but they're being misdiagnosed as ADHD, behavioral problems, drug problems, family problems, when in fact it's the brain injury that they sustained 6 years earlier that was never tracked or treated properly. The CDC has done several studies, one of them out of Minnesota, where upwards of 80% of the kids in our juvenile detention system have some form of brain injury. 80%. In Texas alone, you have over 106,000 kids under 18 in their juvie system. So there you have 60, 70, 80,000 kids that have brain injuries that are not being diagnosed, not being treated, and then you're dumping them into an adult system and you wonder why you have such a high recidivism rate of crime. Folks, this is a public health crisis. Think about having an H1N1 virus occurring twice a year and those kids that actually survive you dump into your prisons. What this piece of legislation is set to do, and I've traveled all over the country advocating on behalf of the incredible piece of legislation that was passed in Washington State 2 years ago named after Zachary Leistat. And last year, New York State had an opportunity to move forward with similar type of legislation. It passed in the Senate. I think it may have been unanimous in the state Senate. For some reason, it got held up in the Assembly, although it passed a couple of committees, it wasn't passed. And so New York and about 10 other states around the country last year passed similar legislation. So there was an opportunity for New York State to maintain its leadership position dealing with health care issues. Instead, what's now occurred with this piece of legislation is going to leapfrog New York State past any other state in this country if this piece of legislation is introduced. The comprehensiveness of this, the fact that it moves beyond just student-athletes, I mean, this is just a remarkable piece of legislation. And, you know, and on behalf of not just Sarah Jane, but the millions of families across the country who have a child suffering from a brain injury, and those millions of families who obviously we want to prevent these brain injuries from occurring, I can't thank you enough and advocate enough to move this piece of legislation through. After the press conference, we're going to show a brief video that will give a major overview of what our entire operation is doing as far as the Sarah Jane Brain Foundation developing this National Pediatric Acquired Brain Injury Plan, which is about a 10 or 12 minute video. As far as I'm concerned, this piece of legislation is going to move New York State into the forefront of healthcare dealing with this issue.
Thank you, Pat. Appreciate it. I just must have tell you that one of the other prime co-sponsors of the legislation so far, and I think we haven't even circulated it throughout the whole conference, but one of the other sponsors is Senator Maziarz, who has his own problems with having slipped and banged his head late. Any questions?
Ken, could you explain a little bit more how it worked? According to the release, you talk about each school having a concussion management team. Would that require new personnel, or
existing
what would their goal be, to set guidelines about when you return to play, that if you have this, you can't return to play?
The whole idea would be take existing personnel at the high schools, put them together as this committee so they're at least meeting together in a formal sense, and then have them evaluate. But there'd be a requirement that there be a authorization from the child's own physician that they're fit to return to play, and that actually we impose a mandatory 24-hour waiting period before they can do that, just so that there's a little bit of an insulation. We actually have found that through the lectures that people have, I get reports back from athletic directors that they feel that there's still too much pressure, the parents don't see anything apparent, and therefore they say, why can't my child play? So that it's and we believe it's welcome that there would be this formal structure. The idea, however, is, of course, we're conscious of costs these days, and that we don't want to mandate any new hiring that otherwise would be done by some new position.
So the athlete would get a recommendation position, but then this committee would still have to review
To look at it to make sure it's a correct authorization and perhaps serve as a little bit of an informal screening. Anecdotally, I've heard people say, you know, I'm not just sure. It is the physician, but that physician is someone who doesn't deal with the brain, not familiar with sports medicine, might be a whole different specialty. So there would be some mechanism that would be there.
And so that committee would have the final sign off on whether a student
Yes.
would return to the campus.
Yes. And there are other systems that are costly that some schools are now employing that are, in a sense, and the closest, people would be horrified if I described it as this, but the closest thing I'd call would be an IQ test. But you need a baseline for the test. And then after there's an injury, you'd give the test again. And the athlete, and it's noticeable lowering of scores when they have a concussion. And then as they recover, and it may take two weeks or may take 2 months, but as they recover, then their scores go back up to what they had been. Now, that obviously is a costly system. It's a time-consuming system. It would require everybody baseline. Where do you do it? There are big high schools. Long Island has them. The Hudson Valley has them. Up here, the Niskayunas, the Bethlehems. You know, there is hundreds of athletes. So, some schools have actually adopted it because they feel it's safe. And then we do know when we're in touch and hopefully down the road talk about further technologies that might make this whole thing a simpler process and then a more widespread process. I don't think so. But obviously, if you involve regulations, someone has to read the regulations, someone has to apply the regulations. But I believe that a lot of people have started to do this on an informal basis, set up something that would be a return to play, saying to their students, we want you, you know, you obviously now have to get a baseline athletic examination, either by the school-provided physician or by your own physician before you can engage in sports in any season. So that's one, and then people will be watching as you have to go get another. So I can't imagine that it's cost less, but I think it's the least cost approach that there is. And actually, as Mr. Donahue has shown with his research, both immediate medical costs and then longer-term societal costs, a substantial improvement, less costly to society.
Are the doctor's order already required to return a student to play?
Not on a formal basis. Some schools do it as an informal basis.
And what kind of liability would this committee have if they were to get, say, a doctor who was just trying to get the kid
I think
back?
We put an exculpation of liability in there.
So they wouldn't be in liability?
You can always get sued for anything, what you write, what you legislate, but I would think that if you have an exculpation, we're going to prevent it.
And I'm looking also at the training. I mean, I'm thinking of a committee of athletic directors, teachers, health professionals in the school having to face a situation where they've got a doctor's order that said a kid can go back to school. What kind of training would they have to sort of back up and open?
Well, that's why we really want to get the doctor, and I think the guidelines anticipate that the doctors would be a neurologist involved, a sports medicine doctor involved. I mean, certainly the case that was cited to me was, I got a return to play clearance for student X, and it was signed by a urologist. So there's, you know, you need something special, but that's in order to do that. I think you need to have the guidelines and we need to involve the State Department of Health and the State Department of Education.
So this would go well past that 24 hour period, right?
Yes. Well, but that's just a precautionary thing. And I think as we learn more and more about the science and more about the research, and there is lots of research going on and published studies and all that, we're going to get a better handle on this situation.
It seems like just the process, though, would be a safeguard for students.
That's, right? Thank you.
But it would, right? I
mean, yes.
It would extend this thing.
That, yes, exactly.
So, you're concerned, do you feel that there are too many cases of students returning to the field of court now before they're really ready?
Anecdotally, we still feel there are.
And there's no way to really tell. I
I mean, you know this yourself. You've got to say a really good athlete who either wants to deny that there was any kind of concussion and just sort of holds it up, a coach maybe supports that, and maybe even a committee. I mean, is there any check on that committee afterwards?
No. Well, we don't even have the committee now. We didn't have the awareness just a few years ago. It was all informal, you know, how many fingers am I holding up? We've gone from that to the sideline guidelines. And, you know, the guidelines for management of head trauma in sports, problems in brain functioning, speed of brain functioning, unusual behaviors, have this at the sideline. That was a beginning. And we're continuing to evolve from there. And I think the statistics from the CDC point out exactly how widespread it might possibly be that we don't even know. Thank you. Thank you very much.
So I'd like to just introduce Rachel Swire from the New York State Brain Association, who obviously is one of the leading advocate organizations in this state advocating on behalf of brain injured families. So, Rachel.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Donahue and Senators, for inviting the Brain Injury Association of New York State here today. We're happy to have the opportunity to speak out about injury prevention during the month of March, which is Brain Injury Prevention Month in New York State and across the country. The association provides support, resources, information to people who have sustained a brain injury, their families, their friends, the public. We strive to be the voice of brain injury in New York State and advocate for resources and for services for people with brain injury, and especially to promote prevention, which is what this is all about. According to statistics from the Centers for Disease Control, which we've heard a lot about today, an estimated 1.7 million people sustain a brain injury across the country annually. And traumatic brain injury is a contributing factor in a third of all injury-related deaths in the United States. And as Mr. Donahue pointed out, the number one cause of death and disability for young people. In fact, an estimated 2 to 3 million, nobody can keep track, of sports and recreation-related concussions occur in the United States each year. The recent deaths of several skiers on slopes in New York State, and this is something that we hear about each winter, has really brought attention to the devastating injuries that can occur in sports. There's no cure for brain injury, and that's why prevention is imperative. That's why the Brain Injury Association encourages parents and coaches to proactively protect students from sports-related concussions. We're happy to work with Mr. Donahue and the State Senate to promote these critical safety measures. Every 23 seconds, somebody in the United States sustains a brain injury. Encouraging, even requiring the use of helmets by skiers and snowboarders and all athletes will reduce the risk of death or injury from sports accidents, and this is certainly something that we can all support.
Thank you, Rachel.
Thank you.
So what we're going to do is I'm going to play a brief video. I don't know if we can dim the lights. Is that possible? Which will give a good overview of our efforts at the Sarah Jane Brain Foundation. I'll be able to answer questions afterwards. So we ready to play?
On a mission to help his daughter and thousands of children like her, kids with traumatic brain injuries, but hers was not caused by accident. Here's NBC's Jeff Lawson.
For 5 days, she was a healthy little girl, but then something about Sarah Jane Donahue was different, and her parents feared the worst.
The story that will send a chill down the spine of any parent, a baby nurse accused of violently shaking a newborn.
Sarah Jane's babysitter admits she shook her. Sarah Jane had 3 broken ribs, 2 broken collarbones, and worst of all, a severe brain injury.
It was trauma. That was when they knew.
And I knew immediately that this monster had done this to her.
Sarah Jane's parents first shared their story on Today in 2005, but a lot has changed. The stress was too much for this marriage. Vanessa and Patrick got divorced, and he got full custody. Sarah Jane is 3 now and loves to play, loves to laugh. In her special preschool, they call her the diva. But as most kids play outside, Sarah Jane is in physical therapy, getting stronger. She's still learning to speak and walk, and her dad, Patrick, dedicates his life.
to the corner and just start crying. That doesn't help my daughter.
Now, Patrick is looking toward the future, putting all of Sarah Jane's private medical records online. He's hoping doctors everywhere unite and offer new treatments.
It really is going to offer us some new and hopefully additional sources of information, ultimately to help children.
The database is growing. Other families are posting their children's medical records, kids with similar brain injuries.
Pulling everybody together, we'll get more answers, and we're better off together than separated.
Sometimes the best ideas start small, and this one that started with a dad and his daughter could spark a medical breakthrough. For today, Jeff Rossin, NBC News, New York.
After launching the Sarah Jane Brain Project in October 2007, we quickly moved into phase two, which was to begin recruiting other families who have a child with a brain injury to participate. What we found out was every family is stuck reinventing the wheel, whether the cause of the brain injury was due to trauma, such as a motor vehicle crash, a sports-related concussion, a gunshot wound, a fall, a blast from war, child abuse, or a non-traumatic cause, such as stroke, brain tumor, epilepsy, or meningitis. All of these injuries fall into a larger group called pediatric acquired brain injury, and the system of care for these families is arbitrary from state to state, random from school district to school district, and a complete crapshoot from one doctor's office to another. The number of these families continue to grow every year, with over 765,000 American youth entering an emergency department annually with a brain injury due to trauma. Over 80,000 of these are hospitalized, and over 11,000 die. These numbers don't include the non-traumatic brain injuries or the many more that go undiagnosed. Basically, every 40 seconds, an American youth enters an emergency department with a traumatic brain injury. When you compare these numbers to other diseases or conditions, and the support they receive from our government is quite shocking. For example, 35,000 new cases of HIV are reported every year, and the federal government spends over $3.5 billion in research grants annually. Or autism, which has between 565,000 to 1.2 million total cumulative cases across the country, and recently the federal government has finally a goal of providing $1 billion in federal research grants annually, which is long overdue. However, the number one leading cause of death and disability for American youth, brain injury, receives less than $10 million annually in federal research grants. Yes, that is million with an M. It is no wonder every PABI family is living in a state of chaos. Since 85% of what all PABI families go through is the same, we are wasting precious resources on every family reinventing the wheel every time this happens, instead of spending our valuable resources on the 15% that makes each one of our children with brain injuries so unique. This is the reason we established an advisory board of leading experts to help us standardize the wheel. Our international advisory board has grown to include over 200 professionals from just about every major medical institution and research university, and it continues to grow and expand today. Over 75 members of our advisory board traveled to New York City during the first week in January 2009 to continue on phase three, which was creating the first ever national pediatric acquired brain injury plan, otherwise known as the PABI plan. By January 20th, 2009, the introduction of the PABI plan was the first letter President Barack Obama received at the White House at 12:01 p.m. on his inauguration day. The PABI plan develops a seamless, standardized, evidence-based system of care that is universally accessible for the millions of PABI families across the country, regardless of where they live. The plan is broken up into seven categories of care. The first category of care is naturally prevention, since it is the only cure for brain injury. These prevention efforts are modeled off of the World Health Organization by preventing new injuries through education and encouragement to reduce high-risk behavior. Engineering safer technologies, enforcement of safe practices, and evaluation of the impact of these measures. Secondary prevention involves reducing the severity of injuries through improved medical practices. And tertiary prevention involves decreased frequency and severity of disability after an injury via improved support structures in the post-acute setting. The second category of care is the acute phase, from the moment of injury, identification, and immediate care, including inpatient rehabilitation within the medical institution. What is amazing is if you were to present one child's case to the top 20 pediatric neurosurgery departments in America today, you would have a dozen different procedures done on that child. The PAPI plan doesn't recommend certain procedures, but rather identifies the translational data points that need to be collected uniformly across all categories of care throughout the country. So based on that actual data, we'll be able to emphasize those procedures that are successful and eliminate those that have higher morbidity and mortality rates. The next category of care is the reintegration phase, or long-term care, where about 85% of our youth spend their time. This is the process of reintegrating brain-injured kids back into their homes, schools, and communities. Conservative estimates suggest over 150,000 children need some special education supports, whether it is physical therapy, occupational therapy, speech therapy, based on the number of youth who are hospitalized each year due to brain injury. Yet the Federal Department of Education statistics only list less than 24,000 students in their database. What is happening to the 125,000 kids every year? The other aspect of the PADI plan is it's a family-centric plan, since a brain injury impacts the entire family, from caregivers to siblings to friends and other family members. The fourth category of care is the adult transition phase, where you're focusing on the 16 to 25-year-old population who suffer from a brain injury. Since the adolescent brain is still developing into their mid-20s, the PADI plan looks to cover this transition phase into independent living, with many of these young adults falling through the cracks within the system. The PADI plan includes more than half the young veterans who are returning home from war in Iraq and Afghanistan with brain injuries, since the average age of a veteran with a traumatic brain injury is just 19 years old. There's a big difference between the way you work with a 19-year-old brain injury survivor and his or her family and a 45-year-old brain injury survivor. We include an entire category of care for mild TBI, since upwards of 90% of all of these brain injuries each year are categorized as mild, otherwise known as concussions. It only made sense to have an entire focus on them. We all know the term mild is a misnomer, since the brain has consistency of hard jello, and sticking in front of a car going 20 miles an hour would be considered a mild traumatic brain injury. The major concern here is when little Susie or little Johnny are playing soccer or fall out of a tree when they're 8 years old and suffer a concussion, and everything seems to be fine. However, 6 years later, when they're in high school and relying on their executive functioning of their brains more than ever, these kids are going from A students to C students, but being misdiagnosed as ADHD, behavioral problems, drug problems, family problems, when in fact it's from the brain injury that was never tracked and treated properly. The CDC has done many studies, one out of Minnesota, where they found upwards of 80% of the kids in our juvenile detention system have some form of a brain injury. This is indeed a public health crisis. As with mild TBI, we created a separate category of care for rural and telehealth. Since about 25% of our population live in rural or frontier regions of the country, with the least access to specialized services and care, in order for this system of care to be universally accessible, we need to focus on this very vulnerable population. Studies also concluded this vulnerable population have higher incidence rates of brain injuries than urban or suburban residents. And finally, the virtual center of excellence is the seventh category of care. This will be the online ecosystem we're developing for not just the repository of data being collected, but we envision utilizing the technology interface to connect all of these families with information and services using the virtual center of excellence as this critical portal between families, professionals, and researchers. One of the geniuses of what the advisory board developed was the idea that no single federal plan would be appropriate for every state. So they created a framework for a state-by-state plan led by one state lead center of excellence in every state, plus D.C. and Puerto Rico, and divided the country into seven regions with seven or eight states or territories in each region. Each state lead center would have three primary responsibilities. First, develop a statewide master PAPI plan to establish a statewide network for data collection and dissemination across the seven categories of care, utilizing already existing infrastructure and organizations like NASHA and the State Brain Injury Associations. Number two, create a high-level case management component so that once an acquired brain injury is diagnosed, we attach ourselves to those families and never let them slip through the cracks. And third, each state lead center would be a regional or national lead for one of the seven categories of care. This hub-and-spoke integrated model will allow for an organized system to collect the data across all categories of care and then be able to disseminate the results in an efficient method. The next fourth phase was to actually implement the PADI plan. So we put out an RFP for organizations, universities, medical institutions to apply to be our state lead center of excellence in their respective state. By June 5th of 2009, which also happened to be Sarah Jane's fourth birthday, my birthday present to her was announcing the largest healthcare collaboration in U.S. history dealing with pediatric acquired brain injury. One institution for every state, plus D.C. and Puerto Rico, was selected as their state lead centers. It is a combination of some of the finest children's hospitals, research universities, and state brain injury associations across the country. We then began securing the support of world-class organizations like the American Academy of Pediatrics, the American Academy of Cerebral Palsy and Developmental Medicine, the American Academy of Neurology, and many other professional and family organizations. We then operationalized the PAPI plan in order to determine the actual cost and organizational structure to implement and run this national effort. We converted that operations plan into a $930 million multi-year grant proposal, creating over 6,000 jobs across every state and territory. The grant was a multi-department grant across seven federal departments, all of which had some role within the PAPI plan: HHS, Education, Defense, Veterans Affairs, Justice, HUD, and transportation. While we were waiting for President Obama to send us the $930 million check, we knew we needed to involve the political process in order to create real systematic changes. So in October 2009, we had House Concurrent Resolution number 198 introduced, which had Congress endorsing the PAPI plan as the plan to prevent, identify, and treat the number one leading cause of death and disability for American youth, and encourage federal, state, and local governments to implement it. Within 6 months, we secured the maximum number of co-sponsors required for any resolution to be afforded an up or down vote, and we ended up with over 110 co-sponsors. We had conservative stalwarts like Congresswoman Sue Myra from North Carolina and Congressman Pete Sessions from Texas, to liberal icons like Congressman Patrick Kennedy from Rhode Island and Congressman Jim McGovern from Massachusetts, all signing on as co-sponsors endorsing the PAPI plan. However, one member of Congress refused to allow an up or down vote by not allowing it through his subcommittee on health, which he served as chairman, Representative Frank Pallone of New Jersey. Notwithstanding Representative Pallone, a national bipartisan political consensus was established, and the next step will be introducing legislation to fully fund and implement the PAPI plan. In the meanwhile, we have made great progress with national initiatives like the Zachary Lysette Brain Project, aiming to advance the core principles established with Zach's Law in Washington State to reduce youth sports-related concussions. We started Sarah Jane Brain Clubs at high schools and colleges across the country to begin getting our youth involved in the effort. And we recently launched a national legal advocacy organization to serve as a legal advocate for these millions of families across the legal spectrum of services. The reason for us gathering today at this town hall meeting is to focus on one of the seven categories of care and discuss the need to implement the PAPI plan within the specific category of care. Our moderator will further explain and introduce our esteemed panel of experts. Sarah Jane is now 5 and a half and a happy little girl. However, she still cannot sit up, crawl, walk, or speak words. It is my job to be a voice for my child, and I'm very grateful for you coming today to be a voice for her and the millions of families like ours out there. Our philosophy is things work out best for those who make the best out of the way things work out.
Light back on. So that would normally be an hour presentation. I figured I'd reduce it to the 12 and a half minutes. What I'd like to do now is open it up if anybody has any specific questions, either about the PAPI plan, about this legislation that Senator Hannon has introduced, or anything specific in general, or general questions. I do not know the number off the top of my head, but it's very easy to go online and find out. It passed unanimously in the Senate. It passed, I know, I think at least one committee in the assembly. Rachel, you don't know the number, do you? It passed at least one assembly committee. It then got kicked over to another assembly committee, and it just died there. And I don't think there was ever any understanding as to why it died.
Have you heard more about the relationship between what's in the proposed legislation and Veterans Affairs?
Say that again.
Actually, Veterans Affairs and what's proposed in the legislation.
Well, I mean, the legislation, this specific legislation that was introduced, is dealing with mild traumatic brain injury, and as you hopefully heard on the presentation, the average age of a veteran returning home from Iraq and Afghanistan with a traumatic brain injury is 19. Many of these, just like about 90% of the civilian population, brain injuries are what's called mild traumatic brain injury. Similarly, in the military, it's probably a similar number as far as maybe a little bit less. But a fairly high percentage of them are mild traumatic brain injuries as well. So there's a lot that we could learn from both. So, for example, in Bethesda, the Department of Defense and VA have introduced at the support of the Fisher and the Intrepid TBI Center in Bethesda, Maryland, they're putting a lot of resources into this effort. And there's stuff that we can learn from what's happening for their vets and the stuff that the DOD and the VA can learn from what happens to the civilian population. Any other questions? Well, I really appreciate it. Oh, Rachel?
I was going to say, can you tell me what the Sarah Jane Brain Clubs are?
Sure. We actually launched the first Sarah Jane Brain Club in New York at Jericho High School out in Long Island. And the concept there is to get high school and college students involved with advocacy and understanding of brain injury, because obviously it affects so many millions of families. So each Sarah Jane Brain Club has started to develop themselves as to what they're doing locally and participating in our national effort. Okay. Well, thank you all for coming, and anything you can do to help support this bill, it literally is going to change the face of brain injury in this country. We pass this bill, so thank you.